Well, I want to start with just sharing a little story about what I was doing yesterday. Christina and I, our lease is about to end in the place that we're living, and so we're starting to look for other places that we're going to be headed to. And we have a list of, like, things that we need. It'd be great if it was close to the church. We have a small group. We'd like a living room that we could actually be able to be in. We need bedrooms that are big enough for our giant bed because our dog sleeps with us. So, yeah, the dog runs the house. So, preferably squirrels in the backyard is what the dog has mentioned to me as well. So we had this list of like five places to go see, and they were amazing. I was pretty sure it was going to be this one. Christina was pretty sure it was going to be this other one. And each house we went into looked so amazing online and looked so not amazing. It's like the fisheye lens made the little tiny kitchen actually look like it was a real kitchen. And so, like, I noticed as the day went on, my joy and excitement turned to frustration and misery. And I kept telling Christina, we're going to find the place. It's going to be okay. And Christina's like, I know we are. What's wrong with you? And I realized that I was losing my hope as we went. I kept saying this to try to somehow inspire myself to be more hopeful. And it was perfectly fitting because we've been doing this series on Hebrews, and we're talking about focus. Like, what do you focus on? And the book of Hebrews is perfect for that because it says focus on Jesus because he's better than everything else. And this one that we're going to look at today is going to talk to us about how do we have hope. And it reminded me that hope is crucial to our lives. It feels like this ethereal, intangible thing. Oh, hope. Be more hopeful. But hope is what gets us out of bed in the morning, thinking that something good might actually happen that day. Hope is the fuel that gives people the strength to achieve things. Because they hope that they can get to this thing. It reminds us that the journey is worth the adversity that we encounter. And without hope, progress becomes nearly impossible. It's so hard to walk through life without hope. It feels like walking through the mud. As somebody who's been depressed before, it's like walking through mud when you don't have hope. And Hebrews is written to a bunch of people who were, they were stressed out. They were under pressure to abandon their faith. And without hope, it's hard to cross through that stuff. And hope is a beautiful remedy for a stale faith. I want you to imagine somebody, or think of someone in your life who you would describe as hopeful. Someone who exudes hope. Do you know anybody like that? How many of you got your person in mind? Think of a hopeful person. I have this kind of picture in my mind for what we do with our lives, and it leaves a wake. Our life leaves a wake behind it. If you've ever been on a motorboat on a lake, there's that ripple that goes out in a nice diagonal from it. And if somebody's sitting on their nice little raft right next to you as you go by them, that wake hits them. That's how we go through life. We leave wakes. And when you're around somebody who has hope, even if it's not your hope, even if you're not very hopeful, you can't help but kind of feel like a little woken up, like coffee. Like there's this energy and this progress and this inspiration that we find in people who have hope. And you want people who have hope around you. It's crucial, actually. If you think of Sandra, who's going to be in this battle with breast cancer, I really hope her doctor has hope. Because if her doctor doesn't have any hope, he's going to go, why bother treating it? Let's just call it over. But with somebody with hope, they go, no, we can find a way to beat this thing. Let's do this together. And you can borrow that hope. If you're in a relationship, whether it's with a boss or with a parent, and you hit a hard time, it's really great if they're hopeful and they go, yeah, we can get this back to good. It's going to take some work, or even with your son or daughter. But when there's no hope, man, it just feels like it's broken. If you're working on a project at work, and you may not be able to see how it's going to be a success yet, but if you're with hopeful people, they go, no, we'll find a way. It'll work out. We can do this. If you want a reason to wake up in the morning, if you want a reason that today could be a good day, we need hope. And hope is incredibly healthy. Actually, there's a psychology study done in the UK of hopeful people. We are picturing that hopeful person. And that person is less stressed, less anxious as a result of their hope. And there's all kinds of disease that goes with that. Hopeful people tend to procrastinate less because they're excited about where they're going and they believe they can get there. They overcome adversity better. They can withstand pain and discomfort in the journey nearly twice as better as somebody who would have less hope. And this was the big surprise to me, because my dad was the eternal optimist, but he was unrealistic about his optimism. He just kind of said, well, it'll all work out, it'll be great. Hopeful people have a tendency to be more realistic than people who have less hope. And they were explaining this, that people who have hope set goals, and then they go, now we got to find a way to get to the goal. And they believe that they can get there, so they actually make a plan. Folks without hope have a vague sense of a goal. It'd be so great if I had a girlfriend, or if I had a better job, or whatever it is. There's no reason to even make a plan, because it's probably not going to happen. And why would I even start the journey? Because it's probably going to fail. I know that I am a person who at times is hope deficient. I was talking to my friend Rachel about this, and she's going, no, you're a super hopeful person. Like, and then she goes, wait a minute, you exude hope for everybody else. Like, I can look at someone and be like, I can totally see how your life could be great. You're a fabulous person. But when it comes to me, I have a harder time doing it. And so I can hope for other people, but not so hopeful for myself. And so I tend to be an Eeyore personality. It's not Eeyore, Piglet. Oh no, no one's gonna remember my birthday. But Piglet's always like, no, this is gonna be great. We can do this. And I'm on this journey that God is taking me on from being an Eeyore to heading to be a Piglet. So in Hebrews passage today actually kind of speaks to that journey. So I hope you'll join me in it. I want to be a little bit like our friend Larry who took the offering. Larry, on occasion, will go, no, God's got me here for a reason. I woke up today, didn't I? I mean, there's something that God has for me. And it's almost like he walks into every day thinking it's Christmas. I just got to unwrap what God has for me today, and this is going to be great. And so I want to go on a journey towards being a more hopeful person. And so we're going to look at Hebrews chapter 6. And we'll do verses 9 through 12, and then verses 19 and 20. If you want to read the 13 through 18, it's this great argument on why God can be trusted, but we won't spend a lot of time in it. It's Hebrews is a fantastic book, but it's got some weird stuff, and so that'd be one of those weird stuff sections. So, all right, let me read this passage for us. Even though we speak like this, and he's referring to how he just spoke about a bunch of people who abandoned their faith and walked away from the Lord. He says, even though we speak like this, dear friends, we're convinced of better things in your case. Things that have to do with salvation. God isn't unjust. He won't forget the work and the love that you have shown him as you've helped his people and continue to help them. We want each of you to show the same diligence to the very end, so that your hope may be fully realized. We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. And we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain where our forerunner Jesus has entered on our behalf. He's become our high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Let's pray. God, as we look into your word, I pray that you would speak into our lives. I pray that you would teach us how to build hope, where to build hope, and that we can have hope as we go through this life. Point us to you, Lord. We love you. Cool. Well, verse 9, right where it starts, it says, dear friends, and it actually, I looked into the Greek, and it says loved ones. Just loved ones. And that's really the starting point of hope in God. Loved ones. You are loved by a God who is big and powerful and in control and has good things for you. In Luke 11, Jesus is talking to a bunch of folks and he says, which of you guys, if you had a son and he asked you for a fish, which of you would give him a poisonous snake? Pretty horrible parenting if you would do that. Or if you wanted an egg to eat, and you're like, oh, here's a scorpion. And he says, if you guys know not to do that, wouldn't your heavenly Father in heaven give you good things? He's even better than you are, so why wouldn't he give you good things? And his point is that it's really simple. God loves you and he wants to give you good things, so of course you can hope for good things. Doesn't always feel like that, but that's the reality. And what we hope for, the writer of Hebrews says, I'm confident in this, it's the things that accompany salvation. And it's crucial to be convinced of your hopes. Hope without confidence is kind of foolish, actually. Stephen Hauschka, the Seahawk kicker, is no longer on the team. He was let go. They brought in another guy, and there's going to be a battle for who gets to be the kicker. And I was thinking, I mean, it would really help the church out financially if I were to go become the Seahawk next kicker. I mean, you guys wouldn't even have to pay me at all to be a pastor. I would be able to fund the church personally, and I would be making probably the NFL minimum, which is like $400,000 a year, for kicking a little ball through two sticks. Now, the only problem with this is I can only kick a ball about 15 yards. So my hope, even though it's a really good hope, probably is not worth us putting our weight down on. It doesn't really make a difference, except you all think I'm an idiot. And I go, I'm going to be the next Seahawks kicker. That's what I'm hoping. Confidence in what you're hoping for makes it work. More personal story about how this worked out. While I was in Bible school, training to be a pastor, for 2 years of my 3 years that I was there, I was dating this girl. The first year, we were on campus together and building our relationship. The next year, she was in Arizona, where she had graduated and moved to, and it was hard. Like, long-distance relationships are just hard. They're a lot of work. It's like all the work and not having any fun together. And so I thought, man, we're just so far away, but this girl's great. And so here's what's going to happen. I'm going to graduate. I'll move to Arizona, marry her. Her dad's a pastor in a student ministry. I can work with college students with him. I got a whole plan lined up. So I moved down there, and within 3 months, we broke up. And I didn't get the internship at the church. And I was, all the things I'd been hoping for didn't happen. And honestly, I was like, God, if you're going to be like this, I'm out of here. And I was ready to like walk out on my faith and ditch the whole ministry thing. And I was floundering and I was just bummed out. But in hindsight, I can look and I can say, man, my hope was actually in a girl. It wasn't in God. I thought, this is what God wants to do in my life, and I've got a plan. Just like, I'd really like it if God wanted me to be the kicker of the Seahawks right now. Got a plan. But it wasn't actually in what God could do. Because if I were hoping in God at that point, I'd go, okay, God closed that door. He's got something else for me. And had I been doing that, I would have realized, thank goodness I broke up with that girl, because that means I should probably move back home. And then once I got back home, I started working at a camp, and at that camp I met this incredible woman who was the arts and craft director named Christina. She's so much better. The hope is in God, though. Jesus tells the story of two guys who built houses, and you may have heard it before. One guy builds his house on the sand, and another guy builds his house on some rock. And I love how he does it in the story. He says, and when the storms came, storms are going to come, things are going to come and shake whatever we put our house down on. The question is it going to stand? And the guy who built on sand, his house washed away. The guy who built on rock, it's a solid foundation. And he ends that story by saying, if you build your house on me and my teachings, your house can stand. When we hope in God, when we hope in the things that have to do with salvation, God being at work in us, saving us, restoring us, bringing us to this place of heaven where things are finally set right, and his work in the world, which is setting things right. When we put our hope in that, it can't help but one, happen, and two, be better than we expect. Ephesians 3, 19 and 20 says this, "Know the love of Christ, which surpasses all knowledge, so that you can be filled up to the fullness of God. And now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond what we could ask or even imagine, according to his power that's at work within us." It's this beautiful declaration of God loves you. He's powerful. He's at work within you. Rest your life on that. He says, the Hebrews writer says he's confident in the things that accompany salvation. And I love that picture of accompanying. It's actually a weak word of like, oh, I'm going to accompany someone. I guess I'll be their Uber driver. Like, that's not what he's saying, is accompanying somebody by just going with them. It's actually something that is attached. It's the picture of an athlete holding tight to something. Like, I know I already did too much NFL, but Marshawn Lynch. Watch him run towards the end zone. There's like eight guys dangling off of him. All of them are like 400 pounds, 300 pounds, whatever, punching the ball, trying to knock it out of his grasp. And he just, locked down, moving forward. And that's that picture. It says, God loves you. He's got the salvation for you. And when you're holding tight to him, you can't get ripped out of your hands. That hope that you have cannot get knocked out by life. I used to play soccer goalie. One of the things that they taught us is after you catch the ball, you curl up around it and you hold it really tight, because on a soccer field, guys like to try to knock it out of your hand. But if you're holding it tight, it's not going to go anywhere. I was never Marshawn Lynch, though. It got knocked out a couple times. But if salvation is at the core of our hope, if God's strength and actually transforming our lives and bringing us to him becomes the foundation on which we live, it can't help but make it to the end. Now, the beautiful thing about that kind of hope is that it's very interesting. It's not on you. You're actually hoping in God's ability to be good, in God's ability to bring you to completion and the world to completion and into fullness. And you end up being the recipient of God's goodness. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. The hope isn't in us, which is why it can last. And when we do life that way, all sorts of things change. We all have bad patterns. We all grew up in dysfunction. All of us have different levels and stuff of it. But your baggage doesn't get the last word. Why? Because God's saving you. So why would your baggage get the last word? Can you expect anything good in your life? Well, it doesn't matter necessarily how you handle everything, and if you handle everything right. Because why? Because God's in the process of saving you, and now you get to partner with him and see how he's going to do it. Will injustices that seem horrible in the world, and there's no easy solution for so much stuff going on in the world. But I know it'll get fixed. You know why? Because God's saving us. When things turn out terrible and don't go the way I wanted, like they did in Arizona, I can still have hope. Why? Because God's in the process of doing something and saving us. No hope in this world can rest like that. If you hope in your career and the economy takes a downturn, what then? If our hope is in our health, which we take for granted so often, what happens when that fades? Prosperity or a person, it's that ball that gets snatched out of our hands by the twists and turns of life, but a hope and a faith and a trust in God and his power to save can't get taken out of your hands. Hope is a foundation. I like how verse 19 phrased it. You have an anchor of hope. We all know what an anchor is. It's interesting, in the catacombs, where Christians would meet to worship and to express their faith, in times when they were persecuted, there's a lot of symbols on the wall. And there's crosses, like you would expect, and there's the fish symbol, which people could draw and kind of anonymously would be able to express to somebody else that they were a Christian, but if somebody saw you drawing a fish, they couldn't like accuse you of anything. But one of the most prominent symbols you find in the catacombs is anchors. Because at that time when they were pushed, they knew that they had something that was solid for the storm, and it was an anchor. Now, I'm not a big boater, but I think we can all get anchors. They drop, and then they hit the ground, and hopefully they lock onto something solid, and then as the boat's blown about, it holds it somewhat steady. Christina had a party at her house recently with Rachel leaving, and one of Rachel's friends was this lady in Maine who, her job was to, when somebody parked their boat, they didn't have like slips like they have here where they park it in like a parking spot. They just kind of got near the bay, shallow water, drop an anchor, and then this lady would roll out and bring them into the harbor. And I was thinking, well, what happens when all these boats are out there and it gets stormy? Well, I guess it's relying on what that anchor locked onto. If that anchor is sitting on some sandy ground, the boat could probably get blown if the winds get big enough. But if it locks into a nice solid rock there on that ground, the boat's not going anywhere. I grew up moving every year. Sort of a weird parental custody plan was like move me from Seattle to California every year. And one of the side effects of that was I better learn to rely on myself. And so for the first half of my life, that was my mantra. You gotta rely on yourself. You can do this. Rely on yourself. And so I made choices according to what I wanted and tried to make things happen. And it didn't end very well with that whole relying on myself. I wasn't a solid enough person to be able to do that. I don't know. I was kind of just left to my own dysfunctions in many ways. I can tell you for the second half of my life, I came to faith at 19 because my life had become such a mess with me directing it. Second half of my life has been an attempt, not a successful one all the time, but an attempt to rely on God. And he has yet to fail me. I've gotten misdirected a few times. Arizona was one of those. But God has yet to fail me. And so the image of this anchor is God. Your rope, it's tied to your boat. You have this rope, it's tied to your life. What are you going to tie the other end to? And then it says this, verse 19 and 20. We have this hope, it's the anchor of our soul. It is firm and secure because it enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain where our forerunner, Jesus, has entered on our behalf. He's become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. In They're describing the temple, and in the inner temple was this curtain, and behind that curtain was the presence of God. The very person of God rested there, and there was such awe and reverence for God that you would only go back there once a year. The high priest would go back into the presence of God, and he would offer a sacrifice, and he would receive the grace and forgiveness and mercy of God on behalf of all the people, and he did this once a year. And Hebrews' point is, if you put your hope in Christ, where is Christ? He's with God in heaven. If you put your hope in him, he will go into the very presence of God and receive grace and forgiveness and mercy for your life every day. It's almost like a tugboat. Instead of just locking yourself onto a rock so that you can sit steady, you're locking yourself onto Christ, and Christ says, well, in the very presence of God, I'm going to bring you into God's presence, and then I'm going to pull you, no matter what else happens, into the best place. So how we build our lives, this front runner, You can't find a place unless you have somebody to guide you there. This front runner is who we tie ourselves to. And then as we put our faith and our life in Christ, as we begin to put our weight down on him, we go, well, maybe I should do what Christ wants instead of just what I want. And we shape our lives and our values and our priorities. And as we do this, we begin to grow hope in better and better things in the world and in ourselves. And we don't just live according to the pattern of the world around us. 1992, there was a huge storm, Hurricane Andrew. And there was a TV camera crew, and they were filming a shot of just widespread, like, destruction from this hurricane. And as they panned the area, one house was totally still standing. The guy was cleaning out his yard. And so they did an interview with him, and they said, "Sir, why is it that your house is still up? Everyone else's house is wrecked." And he says, "Well, I built the house myself, for one. And for two, I built it according to Florida State Code, which is super expensive, but designed to withstand a hurricane. And so when the code said I needed 2x6s, like beams, for every roof truss, I put in a 2x6. And I was told that if I built the house this way, it would stand. But maybe nobody else in my neighborhood built according to code." God is throwing us a line and saying, come with me. I can build your life according to the code. But if you want, you can just do what everyone else is around you and hope for the best. This guy trusted in the code, and I'm sure it seemed costly, and I'm sure it seemed wasteful, and he probably could have built it for cheaper, and that's probably what everybody else was doing. But I think we'd all like a house that stands, right? Verses 10 through 12. How do we actually build this hope? It says this: God is not unjust. He's not going to forget your work and the love that you've shown him. As you've helped his people and continue to help them, we want each of you to show the same diligence to the very end, so that what you hope for can finally be realized. We don't want you to become lazy, but rather to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. Faith in God doesn't produce hope unless you actually put it into practice. I mean, and I love how the writer of Hebrews says, if you want to know how to build hope, well, help some people. Love some people around you. You love God, and then you show that by loving some people around you. Help his people and continue to help them. You ever heard the term a labor of love? It's used to describe like a task that you just love doing. So, you know, cooking dinner for friends can be a labor of love. Like, yeah, it's a lot of work, but it's worth doing. And I like that cliche, a labor of love, but I want to put a little twist on it. And I think it's what God has called us to. And it's a labor of love. It says, if you want to show God you love him, work towards loving some other people. My grandpa had everything. Like, anything he wanted to buy, he'd just go buy it. You ever try to buy a Christmas present for people like that? It's terribly hard. I'm like, well, I could maybe get him like a ticket to an event that he wouldn't normally go to if he hasn't already decided to do it. I tried that once. We went to Blue Man Group. Really loud Blue Man Group drummers in Vegas. He fell asleep. It was nearly impossible to get this guy a present. And when you think about how do we tangibly love God? Can I send him a card? Well, that's tough to do. I guess I could deliver it to the church and hope Pastor Chris reads it to him or something. I mean, that doesn't make any sense. And God is so good, and he goes, you know, I'm hard to do things for. So how about this? All those people out there in the world, they're mine. And so if you want to show me love, show them love. Some of you got a chance to go to Linda's party. It was fantastic. I love what Linda said. She said, you know, I don't really mean anything, so if you want to bring a present, please bring something that we can donate to Union Gospel Mission. And there's this table overflowing. She basically said, I don't need stuff, but how about showing love to somebody who actually needs it? That would be a good way to show me love. And that's what God says to us. He says, all those people are mine. They're made in my image. And so love them if you want a life of hope. And as we love people and work at doing it, it creates hope. It's really hard to figure out how to be more hopeful when things are not hoping. And it's kind of counterintuitive to go, I'm just going to love the people around me and see what happens, see what God can do. And yet that's what we're invited to. To define people by the fact that they were made in his image and to love them. And that produces hope. And it did so in the life of this lady, Agnes, I want to tell you about. Old lady, 1910. Well, she's actually gone now, but in 1910, she was born. Agnes grew up in a home where her mom taught her to give everybody dignity. And these people, she said, they're not your brothers and sisters by blood, but everybody in the world is Christ to you. And I love the term that she learned and she used throughout her whole life, which is, you'll meet Jesus in his most distressing disguise. Now, lots of us grew up in homes where people were told, like, you know, treat everybody with respect and value. But Agnes's mom did something really cool. She invited those people over for dinner on a regular basis and taught her kids to serve them. And so they would have the homeless people and the poor and the unwed mothers and the distressed widows, and they'd all come over for dinner on a regular basis, and she would say, this is Jesus in his most distressing disguise. And that all came from Matthew 25, where at the end of people's lives, they're standing before God, and God says to them, when I was hungry, you fed me. And when I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. And they go, you know, I don't know if that really happened. I don't remember that, God. I mean, I trust you, but I don't remember that happening because I'm pretty sure I would have remembered that face. And he goes, well, no, when you did it for the least one of these, you also did it for me. When you cared and loved and showed love to the least of these, you did this for me. You met Jesus in his most distressing disguise. And so little Agnes learned to do this, and she became a profound woman of hope and joy. And then she became a teacher in India, and she found a whole bunch of people weren't shown love or respect or dignity. So she decided to do something about it and decided to love them as best as she could. That was the whole plan. Not super complicated. That was the whole deal. She became known as Mother Teresa. And her ministry to this day is thriving, and people go to it from all sorts of walks of faith when they don't even know where they're going or what they want to do to try to sort it out because it's a good place to start. Love some people. What if we walked around this week and the people that we met, we said, you know what? It's Jesus. Maybe distressing disguise or not. That coworker we have a hard time with, Jesus, distressing disguise. That person that we see on the side of the road, he's not just a homeless guy at the freeway. He's actually Jesus in a distressing disguise. That person that's bringing us coffee at the restaurant, well, it's Jesus. What if we treat people like that? I had the chance this week to have coffee with Debbie, and I didn't tell her I was going to talk about her coffee. Sorry, Debbie. Anyways, she was telling me how bummed she was that she missed something at church because she had to work. Well, Debbie goes to her job, and she hangs out with 1 and 2-year-olds at a hospital that need daycare. And I'm like, oh. You got to be the church there. Like, you got to do cooler things than church because you got to love on these little tykes. Now, she probably doesn't see it all the way that way because it is her job. But how cool is that? Some of you have so many gifts and different ways to do it. Maybe it's managing projects, and maybe it's offering wisdom, or maybe it's doing whatever it is that you can do. What is the trick this week? Was we're going to go, I'm going to figure out how to love God so I can be a part of what he's doing and have. Maybe it's not that complicated to build some hope in our lives. So, will you do that? Will you join me in doing that this week? We're going to love on some people. We're going to try and trust God, tie our lives to him, and see what happens. All right, let's pray. God, thanks for the great adventure of you being strong and good and powerful and inviting us to attach our lives to you so that you can bring us hope. Thanks that you give us something better to rest our lives on than a bunch of stuff that might let us down. You're fantastic, God. Thanks for having a vision and a hope that you invite us into. We do love you lots.